Hey everybody, this is Renee from The Space Between, and you are listening to The Space Between Podcast, the show that lets you listen to how the fans feel about the music, the art behind over 30 years of the Dave Matthews Band. Stay tuned. Hey guys, welcome to another episode of the Space Between Podcast, the podcast where we tell the story of the fans of the Dave Matthews Band. Each Friday, we bring to you a fan of the Dave Matthews Band to tell us about their journey with the band and, of course, with the community that surrounds the band. So today, you have two Renees to listen to. So if you can't handle double trouble, just take your earphones out right now, turn your radio off. But get ready for a great episode. Today we have Renee, and I'm going to let you tell our listeners a little bit about you, where you live, and then tell us a little bit about Dave Matthews Band. Like, how did you find him, and why do you love this band?
Like, who is this band, right?
Matthews Band.
People who don't, like, get into the music like I do always go, like, why are you so obsessed? Well, I mean, there's a big reason. I'm Renee Hajek. Like you said, two Renees and two Scorpio Renees, like, this is going to be a good time. So,
yeah.
So my story kind of goes like this, and it's kind of a long one, and I do like to talk. So if I ramble, just kind of give me the nudge to chill. I discovered Dave Matthews Band when I was in college. And when I was 21, life circumstances found me relocating from Georgia to California to be with my father and kind of starting a new life as a young adult, finding my career, finding myself lonely and on AOL, like just kind of killing time. And I met this man in an AOL chat room in 1997 about Dave Matthews. It was a Dave Matthews Band chat room. Which was weird because back then, like, you didn't actually meet people that were in chat rooms. Like, this was like straight dial-up times. Like, nobody did that. But we met, we connected as friends. We talked long distance. He was in Chicago. I was in California. And, you know, for a few months, and we just really connected on so many different levels. And I think, you know, Dave Matthews, that anybody who loves Dave Matthews music is almost like a kindred spirit. It's almost like, you know, you kind of connect in that way. So, but yeah, 1997, AOL chat room, Dave Matthews Band, 18 months, we dated long distance. And then I ended up moving to Chicago to be with him. We got engaged, we got married, fast forward 3 kids, 4 states later, ended up back in my home state of Georgia. And we went to 84 shows together. We went through, yeah, a lot. Yes. A lot.
84. Wow.
84. Yeah. And then in 2016, he was diagnosed with stage 4 esophageal cancer. And, you know, obviously that was we had 3 kids and a busy lifestyle and just kind of doing life together. And so, you know, he fought the good fight. We both did. We all did. But he lost his battle to cancer in September 2017. And before he passed, we actually made our trek back to the Gorge, and it was my 40th birthday. So it was a present that he had bought for me, like, you know, right after diagnosis. And we both kind of said, you know what, regardless, if you're sick as can be, we're going to go anyway. And we did. And luckily he was well enough. We did a lot of stuff when we were there. We got to experience the Gorge. That was our bucket list. And so that his last show was Night 3 of the Gorge, 2016. And, you know, after he passed, it took me a while. Like, I didn't even want to listen to Dave for a while. But then I went to a show in Atlanta with some mutual friends. Now, keep in mind, because we were so connected with the band and the music and did a lot of traveling and kind of social folks anyway, we knew a whole lot of Dave fans. And so I went with a couple of my Dave friends to Atlanta. I was like, listen, guys, if I like have to leave, you might have to just go with me. But I didn't. I went, I enjoyed myself, and I decided, you know, this is what I need to be doing. So I went to 20 plus shows in the following like year and a half by myself. And it was fantastic because I wasn't by myself, you know.
Never are.
Never. I have met some of the greatest friends as they say, on the road. And you know, people from here kind of look at me like, you went to Mexico, you went to New York City, you went to Charlottesville. Like, you did all of these things by yourself. And I was like, sort of, but no. I mean, I never was alone. Just kind of connected with this whole fan group. And then, you know, there's some singles groups too, which are, I can't even begin to tell you, as somebody who, you know, is with someone for 20 years and then joining this whole like single realm of dating and whatnot. Like, it just, if there ever is a group to be supportive of being single when you don't expect it, it would be the Dave folks. So yeah,
So when you get to your first concert after the loss of your husband and you hear, and I can imagine that any song after 84 shows together, any song that he could have played in that concert, was it tough for you or did it make you feel close to him?
That it did. It did. And I didn't really expect it. I mean, I was with one of his best friends that, you know, he knew before me. He flew in from Houston. He was from Chicago. He was there. And then my best friend was there. No, at 100%. It lit a spark in me that I hadn't seen in a while, because if you keep in mind, you know, 84 shows, but most of them were when we were like double income, no kids, you know, and then of course we kind of kept it up, but not as much as we did before, but it really did. It brought back so many memories. It brought me back to the place of happiness that we had together when, you know, when life was good and easy and, you know, before all the chaos. And so, yeah, I did. I dug into that. I literally checked all of our bucket lists. I went to Mexico. I did Madison Square Garden. So one of his dying wishes was to have his ashes spread in all of our special places. And so I took some of his ashes to the gorge, and literally me and four girlfriends that I knew from, I mean, you know, Oregon, Oklahoma, Tennessee, like all of these girlfriends that I knew just through Dave were with me as I spread his ashes up in the lawn at the gorge. So, and then, you know, I've been back there twice since then. So it just, it's like an homage. It's like, he is with me. He is 100%.
Absolutely. Oh my God. I love that story. So obviously this podcast is about your story, but your story includes so much of what the community has done for you, especially, I mean, not only when things are great and happy and wonderful and you get to go to these shows together and party, but what does this community look like when you are in a position that you've never been in before, and a position of such loss and grief, and how do I cope, and how do I single parent this after we've been, you know, I've never done that before. How did the community respond to such a crisis when you were in such need, and how did that help you come out of grief a little bit?
Oh, 100%. I can honestly say, like, the 2 years that I spent kind of digging into that, and not just digging into the music, but digging into meeting people and becoming social and finding people that had, you know, like-minded taste in music and in just how you treat people, because really that's what it all boils down to. Tremendous. I mean, all of my Dave family helped me to get to my next stage of life. So that 2 year span that I took off, I, you know, tried to figure out, what am I going to do next? I had worked for my family's business for many years and just decided, you know, I need to do something that kind of pays homage to Dave and what we've been through and my kids and kind of what we stood for. And he was really into craft beer. And so I came across this concept of self-pour craft beer, like, you know, taps, you tap, you pour, you have a little tab going, you pay at the end of your trip, self-serve. And I was like, this is amazing, because it's kind of hands-off, kind of tech heavy. We're tech people. We love, you know, things, technology, and then craft beer. So it all kind of came full circle. And like I said, 2 years I spent writing this business plan, and I'm talking like pen and paper in Mexico with a round table discussion over mimosas in front of the beach. All right, guys, what do you think about this? Right? Like, really and truly, my people that I had met through this community helped me figure out what my next stage of life was going to be. And it was like, I can't even speak highly enough about all of the people that I've met and the lifetime friendships that I made because of this. So we did. Funny story.
Sorry.
One second. This right here, and it is an actual full article, but we had it framed. But this was in the Augusta magazine, which Augusta is known for the Masters Golf Tournament, which is world renowned. You know, everybody knows the Masters. But we were in the Masters edition of the Augusta magazine that was, you know, sent out globally. And it kind of has our story and all about that. Anyway, that to say, wait, what was I going to say? I forget.
Tell us about. So that was about Stay. Is that right? Is that what the article was about? So tell us, what is Stay and how did you come up with this?
That is exactly what I was going to say. So my son, you know, obviously my kids were raised on Dave, right? Yeah. I really feel like they all need tattoos that say raised on Dave because they were. but when we were trying to figure out what this was going to be like, you know, we knew the concept, we knew our mission statement, we knew what we were focused on, and it was bringing people together because that is what I had experienced for the past 2 years prior was just, you know, remaining social, digging into people that are like-minded, digging into people that will help you out in life and kind of making it a place where everybody wanted to come and stay. And my then, oh, let's see, he was 12 at the time, then 12-year-old, he said, Mom. So I think Stay came on the radio or something. He's like, Stay, that's it. You need to name it Stay. And I was like, yeah, you're right. You're right. We do. So we did. And Lucas became the house barista because we were a self-serve tap room, but we were also coffee shop in the morning and full restaurant, all that. And he kind of found purpose through all of that. And then my oldest also found purpose because he's the tech one. So he set up all the technology, everything that we had there. So it really and truly was a full family business. And we had all of the support of the community. It really was a beautiful thing. And it really became exactly what I had hoped it would be. My name is Renee from Evans, Georgia. My friends and I have an important story to tell, all to the tune of Stay. We met in 1997 in an AOL chat room talking about DMV.
An 18-month long-distance relationship between California and Illinois ensued.
They traveled the West Coast and Midwest to many Dave shows together, and she moved to Chicago to be with him.
He proposed to her on Christmas Eve 2000 to the very fitting Christmas song.
Their goddaughter was born while they attended Dave Matthews Band in St. Louis 2001.
And they played that live show at their wedding reception in 2002.
3 children and over 80 shows later, Dave was diagnosed with cancer at age 41.
Dave's last 3 shows were at the Gorge in 2016.
He went to the arms of the Maker, September 2017.
Renee spent the following couple of years exploring the best of what's around and questioning what's next.
She attended 20 more shows with Dave there in spirit, including a trek back to the Gorge in 2018, where she spread some of his ashes in the encore performance of Butterfly.
She always knew that life beyond would include him and them, and the presence of what brought them together.
In a little over a month from now, Renee will open up a social cafe in her hometown in remembrance of their life together.
Appropriately called Stay, to give her community a taste of the good life.
Now, we opened August of 2020, right in the middle of COVID. A social cafe in the middle of COVID. Brilliant. But we did well. We were the only place that had... We had an outdoor patio kind of at our disposal. So we were the only place that was still hosting live music. And it was great. You can socially distance because there's not a lot of wait staff. You literally go to the taps, you pour yourself, you go sit down or whatever. So we really did flourish when a lot of restaurants were going out of business and we had no federal funding, no help because we were so brand new. Right. So we did. We got everything up and running. And then one of my biggest things was being supportive of all people. So I was approached by a group that said, hey, you should host a drag show. And I was like, well, you know, I mean, it's not my thing, but guess what? You know, half the things that happen in here, you know, are not my thing, but they are something for somebody. And they were met with huge success. Like, we sold out the first show within like 30 minutes. And then the second show we added, and fast forward, we live in a very conservative community. And I'm not going to go into the semantics of it all. It's kind of out there on the internet if anybody wanted to get more information on it. But long story short, because of what we supported and because of what we believed in, we were shut down. And so it was, that was a very hard pill to swallow. We went through court battle after court battle, a couple appeals. But because the system that we live in, they found little loopholes to kind of keep us down. And so stay is no longer. So we always, I kind of make the joke, it went from stay to stay or leave.
Yeah.
And now we're
leave.
And now we're left. Now we're left.
So they closed your whole business based on the fact that you had a multiple drag shows there. That is the reason.
Well, that's not what they say the reason is. And there's like I said, there's a lot of semantics to it. There's a lot of details that are out there, but they claimed it was because I didn't get at least 50% of my food sales come from food in the year 2020 when we opened during COVID. But they never did an audit of my books. They never asked for reports. They never, none of that. They got their reports through another entity that literally their job, so it was the development authority, their job was to look at my numbers to make sure, because I got some grant funding in order to operate. Their job was to look at my numbers to make sure that that I was meeting my sales goals. Like I had X number, beat it by 20%. And that was pretty much it. That was the reason I gave them reports to begin with, but they had no indication of gross sales. They were profit and loss reports, which anybody who knows anything about accounting can tell you profit and loss has nothing to do with gross anything. Gross means before any profit, any loss, any deductions, any discounts. Anyway, I'm not going to sit on that just because it's over and it's done with. And here we are now. We'll say everything that we had, my family had, was sunk into that business. Everything, every dime, every, you know, ounce of energy, every time, you know, moment that we had 100% was devoted there. And kind of in our final days, I will say this, so that, you know, we were in business for just over 2 years. And, you know, I'm a single mom with three kids. Literally two of the three kids worked at Stay a lot, but my youngest, my daughter, she was 11 when we had to close down Stay. She was left, not necessarily on her own, but pretty much on her own, right? I was busy all the time and she was here and I felt so, 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 so guilty about it. Like, and I just kept telling her, okay, February 22nd, like that's the date. That it was a Tuesday, February 22nd. That's the day, Wednesday. But Wednesday, once Wednesday comes, this is going to be done. It'll be me and you. Like I kept promising her that. And on February 22nd, which was a Tuesday, she was diagnosed with leukemia. That was the day that we were supposed to be out of Stay altogether, vacated the premises. So, you know, while I question what the hell happened with everything, you know, how successful we were and then just instantly shut down and how pissed off this community is about it, I have to also recognize and understand that, you know, God had something different planned. And the times that I felt guilty about not being with Sully, well, now we're making up for all of that because we're 7 months into leukemia treatment. She's doing amazing. I mean, she has her ups and her downs, but by far and away, just like all of the music that we hear when we listen to Dave Matthews, like she just has that spunk. She has that fire. And, you know, I know it sounds cliche and stupid and people might think, oh my gosh, you guys are a cult or whatever. But honestly, I have found so cool, right? Sign me up. Exactly. Like, I feel like we should hand out pamphlets or something. We should be like the witnesses.
Disciples now. Have you heard of Dave Matthews?
Right. There's a concert coming up in Savannah, which is funny. Oh, real quick, funny story. Not funny story, but like, this is completely off topic, but just something that I found was very helpful for me when going through my 2 years of self-finding. You know, we were a part of the Dave Matthews Band singles group and everybody's talking about going to Charlottesville, you know, to the Mecca, to the home where everything started. These people are going and these people are going, well, where are you staying? Well, where are you staying? And everybody's got like one person hotel rooms. And I was like, listen, guys, like we're all adults here. Let's get a huge ass Airbnb, right? And we'll kind of host little like interviews or whatever to, you know, make sure not everybody's, that everybody's on the same like sanity level or whatever and mature, right? And we had the absolute best time. There were 10 of us, five guys, five girls, this really old house in downtown Charlottesville, literally had the best time. We played guitar, we sang, we went to the winery, we toured around, and literally all kind of became 10 best friends in that moment. So we're doing the same thing in Savannah. What's that?
When was your trip to Charlottesville? When was that? What year was that?
That was in 2018. So it was, yeah, November 2018. Yep. And so a couple of the people from that group and then some new people, we're all doing the same thing in Savannah. So we're going to go from Sunday to Wednesday and the concert's Tuesday night. But just like, and it's like reuniting of old buddies and welcoming new buddies. Like it's going to be so much fun. And I, you know, that I think has been one of the most strengthening aspects of my journey through grief has been the Dave Matthews fans that have kept me going. For sure.
I mean, it's time and time again. I mean, every time I get to speak to someone, it is the same story, but it is all such a very different, because it's personal, right? It's a very different story. But the common part of all of these stories is exactly what you're saying. The community of people that they have been involved with because of a band, right? Because of a band. Their whole world has just been wrapped in a community that is here to love on others and serve and leave a legacy of love and hope and friendship. And so it boggles me that not more people know about this cult, right?
right.
It saved so many of us when we were in our deepest, darkest times. And it just, I can't imagine going through a lot of those times. And I'm sure that you really can't imagine looking back through all of that without this community of people, yeah. Right? Like it just would have been totally different for you, for your family, for everyone. And so it's so good to hear stories just like yours, because again, it's just like confirmation that I'm not crazy, right? Like this really is happening. It's not just happening to me. It's happening to most people that are part of this group that are open-minded and willing for it to happen, right? Because, you know, I'm sure people could go, oh, you know, seems like a bunch of dicks here at this Dave Matthews. You know, you've heard it all, right? Like the hacky sack frat boys, like, dude, we're in our 40s and 50s now.
Right. All that stuff. That's water under the bridge, right? Yes. 100%.
Not happening. I mean, there may be some frat boys there. Matter of fact, I saw several at concerts, but it's not us, right? Like right. For the most part, it is more seasoned adults that go. And I feel like what a great time to have a community around us, because we didn't necessarily need all of this when we were 18, 19, 20. Would it have been great? Absolutely. But we find as time goes on with life, there are more hurdles to get across, right? Whether that's mm-hmm. death, whether that's sickness, whether that's changing jobs, losing jobs, like all of the having kids, losing kids, like all of those things are some of the most tough things that you'll ever go through in life. And so to have a support group around you already that's there to help you, I mean, as a nurse, you know, I preach grief all of the time. And one of the biggest components to helping with grief is supporting or having a community of people around you, right? And so that's exactly what happened with you. And that's exactly what needed to happen. But what's great about this group is, like you said, we're all like-minded, right? We do love the same band, but And that was like the connection for us to find each other. But then it turns into so much more, right? Because most of us are parents or spouses or aunts and uncles or whatever we are. But there's more commonalities besides just the band, right? But that's just like the key to get into the club. Right.
That's that's the secret code word. Dave Matthews Band is the secret code word. There it is. Yes. But you know, just like I have experienced so much support from everybody around me, I've also seen some of my best DMV friends, you know, go through job loss, parent loss, like relationship loss, moves across the country. Like it has become so much more than any, you know, local network of friends that you could possibly find. And, you know, some of these friends I don't talk to for 8-9 months, but then we pick up the phone and it's just like we're best buds. We haven't even dropped a chord. So I mean, Facebook probably has a lot to do with that because you do feel kind of connected to what's going on.
We live in such a good time. And I say that and everyone's like, you're so weird. But I'm like, there's never been a better time to be alive than right now because we have so much at our disposal. It's so easy to like reach out to someone or, you know, just check on somebody. And so we
Renee, do you know how badly I needed to hear that right now? I really did need to hear that. Right? Right here, right now.
There's never been a better time to be alive.
I do struggle with all of the loss and everything that I've, you know, gone through that we've experienced, you know, the business, all that. There was one more thing that I didn't say that also probably should go said. When the business shut down, Sully was diagnosed February 22nd. My middle child, the one that named Stay, our business, he totally fell apart, like lost his sense of purpose because working at Stay was where he belonged. And he didn't only work there, he was training employees and like he got to know my customers. Like, so he kind of fell into a depression and kind of went off the rails. And before the end of March, and this was not an easy decision, it was something we really had to struggle to come to terms with, we decided to send him away to a boys' school. So he's been gone since March and I have kind of limited contact with him, but I will say in raising money to get him there, because obviously, you know, my business has just failed. Every dime that I had was in that raising money to get him there, to get him the help that he needs, which, you know, like I said, 7 months into it, he is doing amazing. But a lot of that came from the Dave community as well. Like they have been absolutely incredible in every aspect of my life. So I know that was a little detour, but
no. I mean, that just goes to prove not only is this community pouring into you, but they see the importance of also feeding into your family, right? Like, how is your kid? Is there anything I can do? How's your, you know, all of those things. And that's when, you know, like shit got real, right? It's not just a surface relationship. Like they're digging down to see how can I really help you? And sometimes you can only help me if you help someone I love, right? So that's exactly what they recognized and they're doing. And so, right? It's mind blowing. It's mind blowing. And I know you feel this way. I feel so blessed to have this group. And that's going to sound crazy to people that might listen to this that are not like into Dave Matthews Band, but this is more than just music. It's so much more than music. I mean, yes, the music is great and it can heal and it can do so many things, but God, you know, just this group.
I think the biggest part of it all, and this kind of is like the root of connection, is self-reflection. And every single one of Dave Matthews' songs, there have been times where I've listened to a new album and been like, man, that song's really awful. And then like four times listening to it later, I go, okay, it's not so bad. And then it becomes one of my favorites. But I feel like all of the songs, they really make you go like, hey, think about this for a second. How does this song relate to you? And in some way, every single song has a relation to every single listener always. And so I think that self-reflection part of the music really lends itself to connection, because you can't connect if you're not self-aware. You can't connect unless you know what you have to offer. And, you know, that I think that's been one of the biggest lessons that I've learned through the grief process, because, you know, Dave meant a lot more to me. Well, a lot different to me when it was my husband and I going, you know what I mean? Listening together, that was our thing. And now it's totally different, but still I mean, just as meaningful, if not more so, you know?
There was definitely a moment that you thought you couldn't go on with Dave because that was something that was so much of yours as a couple. And aren't you glad that you didn't listen to that little voice in your head that said, you know, you're going to have to give that up because you'd already lost so much. And so I'm so glad that you listened to that little voice and continued to grow closer to the band, but not only to the band, but to grow closer to this community, because it sounds like they've just been a part of everything that you needed and been the rock that you needed when you didn't necessarily have your rock anymore. Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah. It's mind-boggling still to me every time. Okay, guys, so if you are listening to this on a podcast app, just know if you want to see this, you can also watch it on our YouTube channel, which is just simply The Space Between Podcast on YouTube. And so I want to talk a little bit about all of the things behind you, because I haven't seen all of those things. What is going on? Can you show me the thing that says, I came in praying for you? Like, what is above the words?
Ooh. Well, okay. Okay. So I'm just going to give you the kerfuffle. This is from my business, all of my posters and it's a total mess, but you asked. So there you go.
Penny, oh my God.
So I actually have a man cave upstairs that we're prepping to make it all Dave stuff, but that thing specifically. So this was for our 15th wedding anniversary, and he was very sick when I had this made, but I had, I don't know if you can see, the blue line there was, are all the places that we have lived together in the 15 years that we've been together. And then, you know, I came in praying for you, obviously, you know where it came from. And if you don't, then you should.
That's right.
You gotta do some studying. You'll have to do some studying. Okay. So if anybody needs any ideas of what to do with their ticket stubs, come see me, because I did a resin cast. I made like a coffee table with all the ticket stubs, actually two of them, actually more than that, because I have 117 of those bad boys to show. But
God.
It used to drive me crazy because my husband would be like, don't wrinkle that. Don't fold that. We're keeping that. I'm like, what the hell are we going to do with all these ticket stubs? And that's when we were at like 20.
Oh. And
fast forward, and I had them plastered everywhere in my restaurant. So if anybody needs an idea, I got you. It's art. It's amazing.
Ideas. But, I mean, if anyone is listening and you're like me, I have a drawer full of ticket stubs and like no idea what I'm going to do with them. I was kind of like you, Renee, just like one day. I can never throw them away. That's like, it's memories, right? It's weird. Even though we are in the digital world where I could like literally pull up videos from any concert I've ever been to, I still need those ticket stubs.
You need the ticket stubs. You do. Yes, you do. Do not throw them away.
It's the old school in me, right? Like, it's like a ticket stub. I still have movie stubs from when I was in high school. I don't know why, but I do.
Well, they hold us back. But if you look at them, you remember who you were with, what you were wearing, right? What
it used to be $5 or $4.25. What? Anymore. Oh my God.
Funny.
So we're gonna wrap up this episode. First, Renee, I want to say thank you for sharing your heart with our listeners. I think, again, it's just so important to remind people of how special this community is, because sometimes when we get really used to having a great life, you know, or a great community, we forget how really special it is, because this is not something that is super common, right? We want to think that the whole world is a Dave Matthews Band fan, but they are not. And I think we all know that when we get outside of our bubble, we're like, oh shit, like there's no one around me listens to this. I'm like the only person.
Right.
But it's good to remember, like, hey, you have something special. You have something that is not common. And so again, that's what this story is capturing, is just how much good has come from this band, not just music, but everything else. And so, you know, if Dave and the boys ever get to hear any of these stories, I want them to know, and they probably already do, but I want them to know what they've made on our lives and in our hearts, not just musically, but like in a profound, like spiritual way, right? Like, and I don't know if they can ever understand that, because, you know, you have to separate like being in the band and a fan, and that's just very different. But I hope that one day they really can kind of understand just a tenth of what we're saying in this, and all of the good. And I believe that when you put good into the world, it's perpetual. It just keeps going. It keeps going, and it gets bigger and it gets bigger. And that's exactly what happened with you, right? Like, it kind of started out small, and you went on all these shows, and look how big it is now. It's so much bigger than you. Yeah. So much bigger than me. It's just, it's amazing.
Well, and I feel like my story, like I've had a little speed bump, but I've got so much more to tell and so much more life to live. And my daughter has so much more life to live, and she has her own stories to tell, and they will all include Dave Matthews Band.
Whether they like it or not, right?
Right. Oh, they love it. They all do. They all love it.
That's so refreshing. I'm not quite there with my kids. Right now, it's just the mommy thing. One day. One day. Back and go, you know what? That was my mom's favorite band, and that's all I need. So tell us, we're going to talk about fall tour a little bit, and then maybe a little bit of next year in our closing thoughts here. So you're going to Savannah.
Yeah.
And so you've got to Savannah
with a group. Yeah. And going to Greenville. My daughter is in one of the last really hard phases of chemo. So even this trip is going to be a little bit difficult. Just making sure she's managed while I'm gone. But I'm confident it's gonna happen without a hitch, and she's gonna do well. And then, so beyond that, I don't know. It's very hard for me to plan, but I promise you this, if and when everything is good and back to normal and we're on schedules and my son is back from school, I will be back at it again. And I want to go to Mexico again.
Celebrate, we will. So many big things. Your daughter's going to get better. It's happening. Yeah. We're going to put it into the world right now. She's a strong girl. She's going to do it. And look at her mama, strong lady. She can do anything, right?
Of course.
She's got it in her bones. And so, yeah, celebrate we will. And so that is your story for now. But believe me, we're going to catch up with you in a few months, and we're going to see how things are going. And because the story continues, right? It's not over. It continues and it changes. And so, Renee, thank you so much for being willing to share your heart and your personal story with the listeners of this podcast. And so, guys, again, if you are listening to this on a podcast app, just know that you can watch this on YouTube. And the best way to stay connected with this podcast and to see who is the next guest that's on, because every week it's a new guest telling their story around the Dave Matthews Band. Facebook. We've got a group called The Space Between Podcasts. On Instagram, it's just The Space Between _POD. And then, of course, we're on all the other things, Snapchat and TikTok. But you don't want to watch that, because do you really want to see me doing bad dances? You do.
We need like a standard dance move. All your podcasts. All your podcast interviewees need to do the same, like, little...
We're going to do the nay-nay, the whip and nay-nay, because we're like the nay-nays, right? I don't even know how to do that.
Well, okay, my late husband's thing was the robot. Yeah, that was his thing. The robot, yeah.
That's a future thing. It starts here on this episode, and everyone after, we're going to do the robot.
Doing the robot.
It's horrible. But so much fun. So Renee, thank you so much. Guys, be sure to stay tuned. We have a lot of course, always a new episode every Friday. So guys, stay connected and love on each other, because that's what we're here to do, guys. So everyone, peace, love, and Dave Matthews Band.